Thank you so much, Doug, and I'd like to welcome everyone to this short presentation about Magnificent Malta. As Doug said, we've all been cooped up in our little areas around, and we will all be ready very soon to fly over to Malta and for a new adventure. I surely am. I'm based here in New York City, so I really look forward for the day that I can go back home and visit our beautiful islands. So I'd like to start firstly to explain where we're located. Yes, it is a question that comes up. Malta is an archipelago of islands 58 miles south from the shores of Sicily, right in the middle of the Mediterranean, as you can see. The islands have mainly three islands. The biggest island of Malta is where all the major, you can find all the major attractions like the airport, the cruise port, lots of the hotels and attractions, and is the largest of the three islands. The sister island of Gozo, second largest, is the mythical island of Calypso in the Greek mythology. More rural, for those ages that are in the New York area, I always like to say it's like the Hamptons for the Maltese. So it's a little bit more relaxed. And whilst it's smaller, it still has all the amenities that the Big Island has. So you have five-star hotels. Gozo is also famous for their farmhouses, luxury rentals. And you can still find historic sites, which I will go through along this presentation. In the middle, you have the island of Comino, which is a small island surrounded by blue lagoons, great for day trips, whether you go on a private yacht or you just cross over from the islands with a scheduled ferry, and you can spend the day there swimming. It's famous for its blue lagoons, so it's definitely a must-see, whether you see it on your way to Gozo or you suggest for your client to just visit for half a day or a day. Malta is part of the EU, and we use the euros, and the population of about 430,000 people. I'd like to say 500,000, just to round it all up. And though we are only 216 kilometers squares, it's being that we're small, it's actually an advantage that I will talk about throughout my presentation. You save time, you save money, and you have a richer itinerary. Why Malta? We have 7,000 years of civilization, 7,000 years of history. So starting from prehistoric civilizations all the way to the British colony and all the way to Malta being part of the EU and a republic. We have temples that date back 3,600 before Christ, older than the pyramids of Giza and Stonehenge. Civilizations that even scholars don't know much about. We do know that the culture was worshipped goddesses, and we know that by all the findings that were discovered around the temples. We are also the islands of St. Paul. The Apostle St. Paul was shipwrecked on his way to Rome, bringing us the new religion back then. So it's predominantly Roman Catholic with over 380 churches on the islands. Yes, it's a lot of churches, but definitely worth seeing, and I'll talk a little bit about that too. Superb accommodations, which I will explain a little bit more in detail, from major chains to the smaller boutique hotels. We are also lucky to have 300 days of sunshine. Average temperature is about 77 degrees. 90s in the summer, 50s, 60s in the winter. So summers are long stretched from May until October, November. So it's really great for an all year round destination. Now, with 7,000 years of history, there is no way that a webinar I can go into any details about our history line. But what I'd like to talk about is the Knights of Malta, being that they have left such an amazing infrastructure and still very visible until today. It's definitely worth talking about the Knights and their impact on the islands. Infrastructure, culture, and the way we live. We have three UNESCO sites, And I will talk a little bit about that later on as well. But one of which I'd like to point out here is our capital city of Valletta. It's a city UNESCO site. So they couldn't decide if there was one part of it that was worth to be on a UNESCO site. They've decided to give that to the whole city. Built by the Knights of St. John in the 1500s, it's a masterpiece in every corner. As I said, we are small but mighty with short driving distances. I'd like to talk a little bit about actually getting around the islands. And I could go back to the map of the islands. There is a ferry schedule from Malta to Gozo that runs every 20 minutes, 24 hours a day, a little bit less frequent during the night. So that is very easy. You can take the car. You can take your car if your clients have rented a car. You can cross over with the car, or you can public transportation is pretty good around the islands. Your client can rent a car very easy. There's all major car rentals there. We do drive on the other side of the road, like the British. So we like to, I'd like to say we drive on the shady side of the road. So that's something that if your client's not comfortable, just to remind that we do have the British system of driving. Of course, as I said, public transportation or private drivers, very accessible on the islands. Getting into Malta, for North Americans, we are part of the Schengen agreement. So for North Americans, there is no need for a visa. I know it's a common question at the moment. When are we ready to reopen? When are we ready to reopen for North Americans? Well, we've just heard that the airport will open July 1st for about 15 countries. And we will send you information on that. North America is not part of it yet. And when we do have that information, we will surely keep you informed. I suggest also that if your client has any medical issues or have to take medicine with them, just to keep them in their original packaging. And if there's any questions, also to check with our local embassies, which we have two, one in Washington, D.C. and one in New York City. But we're here to help you as well. Connections. Of course, this can change and will change. I just wanted to give you an idea. We do not have a direct flight from North America, but you can connect through any major hub in Europe. So whether your client is flying into Rome and Alitalia, Air Malta, flights daily, very frequent from all over Italy, from England, obviously London, Gatwick and other parts of England, Germany, Amsterdam, Belgium, France, and Turkish Airlines has a great connection through Istanbul, Emirates and Qatar through Milan. So depending on what your client like to fly, you would surely find a connection. Obviously, this could change until we get back to the normal routes and all the airlines flying, obviously, when that time comes. But again, we will have all that information for you. And just to give you an idea of how close we are to any of these major hubs, the longest you'll take is to London Gatwick. It's about 3 hours from London Heathrow, really, really close by to Rome, and Catania, 40 minutes. So keep in mind as well, Malta can also be sold with another destination. And a common question is, what destinations do you see Malta being sold with? Obviously, the most common one would be Italy, Sicily. And there are boats from Sicily that takes you right into Valletta as well. So if your client don't want to fly from Italy to Malta, you can take a catamaran from Pozzallo or Catania, and you can find yourself in the Valletta port. So pretty central on the islands. Talking a little bit about our UNESCO site. So one UNESCO site is what you're looking at here is the Hypogeum temples, which is one of the few subterranean temples found around the world. Again, it's a culture that scholars don't know much about, and they are constantly studying. Very spiritual. It's definitely an experience. Tickets for the Hypogeum can be sold. We recommend that you get the tickets pre-arrival, even 3 to 6 months before. I mean, it's the last minute, obviously, you can always check for availability through the Heritage Malta site. And again, if you need any of that help, you can come to us as well and we will help you. But it is a tour, it's like 12 people at a time because it's pretty sacred and a must-do experience. The other UNESCO site is a cluster of seven temples as well. One of them is in beautiful Gozo and the others around Malta. So definitely a must visit. And then, as I said, the city of Valletta. What you are looking at is the co-cathedral of St. John, built by the knights, gold gilded. It represents the knights and their glory. And the Maltese cross has 8 points that represented the 8 different origins of the knights. And you'll see chapels around this beautiful co-cathedral that represents the different nationality of the knights of St. John. In the co-cathedral of St. John, you will also find the only signed Caravaggio painting, the beheading of St. John the Baptist, and is the only signed Caravaggio painting, which is incredible. It is an open-air museum. Though small, one can enjoy Valletta during the day when the hustling, bustling of the crowd to the more relaxed evenings with all the bars and jazz bars opened. Valletta is alive 24 hours a day with these beautiful streets. A fun fact is that Valletta was actually built with the grid method, one of the first cities in the world. And after Valletta, they used that plan to many other cities, including our beautiful New York City. It is built in the grid system for ventilation. And in Valletta's case, the access to the ports, which was a very main area for the merchants and everyone doing business in those areas. Accommodations in Malta. We have over 138 hotels, and from international chains like Marriott, Hilton's, we have a Hyatt opening up, luxury hotels like Inyala, to leading hotels of the world, the beautiful hotel Phoenicia in Valletta, to preferred hotels Raleigh Chateau, the Shara Lodge in beautiful Imdina, which is another medieval city in Malta, to 4-star hotels, 3-star, all-stars hotels, really, to these small boutique luxury hotels. You'll find these hotels throughout the islands, but mostly in Valletta and around the area, and even in the island of Gozo. One can experience Malta in a different, you know, in a different way, on a more intimate level. What you are looking at is a picture of the Corinthia Palace. The Corinthia Hotels, which most of you know for Corinthia London, is actually a Maltese hotel, and it has its first hotel that was opened on the islands. Very rich in history, family that opened their hotels firstly in Malta and went on internationally, very successful, and we're very proud of them. I want to talk a little bit about the different niche markets that come to Malta. Being that we are so diverse, it allows for many different kind of niches to visit us, attractive to many niches. And one of them is wellness. Being that we have the spiritual aspect of, you know, we have a lot of yogis coming to visit the temples for summer and winter solstices and yoga sessions at the temples, which I personally experienced. And it was an amazing experience, to hotels and spas opening up, the beautiful waters, whether it's for relaxation or therapy. Malta's wellness market has picked up a lot in the last 3 years. The Maltese food, I mean, what can I say? 7,000 years of history bringing so many cultures through, you know, visiting us and stopping over, and everyone left a little bit of them. So you can see that in the food, taste it in the food as well. Being that we are islands, of course, seafood is very popular, from fresh fish to just lobster seafood to more of a Mediterranean cultural. So you have a pasta dishes with a North African flavor, makes us a little bit diverse. You can have dinner in a typical piazza, as you see, open air, being we have great weather. To a more of a luxury setups, we do have three Michelin star restaurants in Malta. To a traditional Maltese food with entertainment, and I always suggest you do that. There's plenty restaurants that offer Maltese cuisine, and I like that because you really can eat like a local. Malta, again, because of its climate, very popular with adventure and nature holidays. So whether it's you're a diver and like to see what's underneath, like as much as you'd like to see what's on land, Malta is very rich, often voted as most popular diving destination in Europe. You can find sites from Phoenician shipwrecks all the way to World War II ships. As I say, there's definitely a lot to see under the sea as much as there is on land. Information about diving trails and snorkeling trails and companies that can help you and your client to organize such holidays are found on our Visit Malta website. You just go to the different niches and it directs you to the right entities and people that can help with that. Apart from diving, of course, there's sailing, paragliding, and all water sports to a more, hiking, cycling. As a matter of fact, we have marathons that people come from all over the world to run, to golfing, rock climbing, cliff hanging. So again, more information on that on our Visit Malta website. As I mentioned before, the faith-based travel, very, very popular with the Maltese island. As I mentioned before, usually you find these religious pilgrimages. A lot of tour operators offer these kind of religious pilgrimages. You will find that Malta's grouped with Rome and with Italy and Turkey on these religious pilgrimages, following the steps of St. Paul. You can still see the original catacombs where the early Christians used to worship. Two beautiful churches, as I mentioned. We celebrate Malta is very popular during Easter events. This is a church during Good Friday, so you'll see that very vividly. To a Jewish infused travel. We've launched a couple of years ago a program where it highlights the Jewish presence in Malta, and you'll find tours that have a Jewish infused for your clients that would wish to see that in Malta. Malta is also frequently sold with Israel, so we have flights, daily flights to Tel Aviv, and a lot of North Americans combine the two destinations together. This is a typical festa, which is a festa is every village in Malta have a patron saint, and starting from May all the way to October, each village celebrates their patron saint. Of course, any excuse for us to be outside. There's the band playing, local food is being offered, people are all together, and fireworks. We have to have fireworks in it for every occasion. So definitely check the events calendar on our Visit Malta website. And saying that takes me to the Malta Festival and Events. Besides of the festas, obviously one can enjoy musical festivals from baroque music, jazz, to the Isle of MTV, more millennial-based summer festivals, to classical music. Apart from music, we have festivals like the Vintage Grand Prix. You have in the background there the medieval city of Imdina, which Imdina used to be the capital city of Malta, and it's called the Silent City, gorgeous, smaller scale of Valletta. No cars are allowed apart from the local residents. And again, it is a gem. So you have these festivals, a lot of reenactments, pageantry, the Birgu Fest, what you see down there, which is the city of Birgu, all candlelit with lots of music and food. So it's definitely always worth to check what is going on while your client is in Malta, because it just gives you the experience of living like a local. And it is all year round. We're very happy to say that our events calendar is all year round. Great destination for honeymoons and weddings. Of course, as you see, the backdrop is just amazing with lots of history behind it. You can find palazzos, from palazzos to modern halls for weddings and backdrops for pictures and photo opportunities. It is locally, you know, centrally located. Therefore, people can fly from all over for that special wedding or honeymoons. I am originally Maltese, but I actually did my honeymoon. One of my honeymoon stops was Malta because I did marry an American. And that was a great way how to see the Mediterranean and stop over in Malta. So definitely a honeymoon destination. A little bit more about the island of Gozo. As I mentioned before, the island of Gozo is the mythical island of the goddess Calypso. Gozo used to be called Calypso before, and it is more rural, great for adventure. What you see in the picture on the left-hand side is the salt pans of Gozo, which are very popular to visit. These date back to the Roman rule, where the Romans used to harvest their salts and then use it as a salary. And as a matter of fact, salary comes from the word sale, which in Italian is salt. And salt was a currency back then because it was important to restore, keep food for when they are out at sea. So Gozo has a very rich history, has one of the UNESCO sites of Gigantia, which is one of the oldest temples on Malta. Gigantia is named after the big stones that it's built with, which Gigantia comes from the word giant. So the structure is pretty impressive. So Gozo, whether you have time to book your client to stay for a couple of nights, you have accommodation like Kempinski and other five-star hotels, to the smaller boutique experience as well. And also the farmhouses for family travel or multi-generational travel that maybe they do want to stay in a private villa. Gozo is the ideal place. Corporate opportunities for those who do book corporate opportunities. Malta, the corporate business in Malta has been gaining momentum year after year, whether it's for the actual corporate meeting or incentives, it's definitely ideal. It is an open air museum, so you can have some really amazing setups. What you are looking at is the Mediterranean Center conference center, which used to be a hospital for the knights. And it's built in Valletta, which back then, I think the knights were privileged to, were the first ones to build a hospital within city limits. It is, the setup is grand. Every time I see it, I'm amazed every time I look at these setups. So there's opportunities for that too. Malta is a central hub for a lot of cruise itineraries. We have over 13 North American cruise ships that stop in Malta. The port, the Valletta cruise port, is within Valletta, and it's the bed is deep base, so the boats actually anchor in the port. We do have itineraries where you can stop for a day. When you stop for a day, your clients will enjoy Valletta or even go to Gozo and Imdina because of the proximity. Or there are also itineraries with a pre and post possibilities, which is very good because you can see the islands. And what we've been seeing is that it's like people come on the cruise ship, see these beautiful islands, and say, I have to come back. There's so much more than you would ever thought. So this is my information. We have you, as I said, I mentioned a lot the Visit Malta website. It has a lot of information there that is useful. But we also have a Travel Agent Academy course that you can take. It's about 20 minutes, and it just helps you how to sell the islands and what they can offer. I have a little video that I would like to show. You might experience that you can't hear the audio, but it's just it's been working. It hasn't been consistent, so we're gonna try to play it. So thank you very much again. That definitely makes me homesick every time I see it. So now, as Doug said, we will do a follow-up. We'll send you this presentation again. And if you do have any questions, we're here to help you.
Fantastic. Well, thank you, Michelle. Your visuals are stunning.
Thank you.
As Michelle mentioned, this webinar is being recorded. We will send you a copy of that recording. You can also find it on our website, which is jacksfacts.com, under the advisor training tab. And now let's jump into a couple questions. Michelle, one of the things you mentioned was Malta is sometimes combined with other destinations. What would you recommend as the average length of stay in Malta?
Okay, yeah. So let's say your client have 7 to 10 days. I always say at least minimum four nights for Malta when you're combining it with another destination. You want your client to come in and be able to see the highlights of Malta, and I would think 4 nights, 5 days. It's a good start.
Mm-hmm. Perfect. One of the things that you had mentioned is the availability of a ferry between Catania and Valletta. Do you know how long a ride that is?
So I know that from Pozzallo, which is a little bit further down, the catamaran takes about 90 minutes. Details on how long and the frequency of the schedule can be found on the ferry company is called Virtu, V-I-R-T-U, and whoever asking can email me directly. I can send them the link. But it's about catamaran-wise, it's about 90 minutes. And then, of course, to fly, it's like 40 minutes and you're there from Palermo, Catania, or on the west coast of Sicily.
All right, perfect. Somebody's asking if they still observe siesta in Valletta. Apparently they were there in 2000 and missed something because the cathedral was closed for siesta.
No more siesta. we're on with the no, there is no siesta. Stores are opened actually all throughout. My grandmother still have siesta, but that doesn't bother anyone. But no, the stores are still open, and so are the local attractions.
Awesome. Another question for you: how accessible is Malta for the mobility impaired?
Actually, Malta, you'll find that it's actually very well equipped when it comes to mobility. There's ramps and elevators, whether it's open elevators or the closed elevators, in every site. And of course, hotels are all equipped.
Okay, great. Let's see what else we have. Somebody commenting on your beautiful presentation. I agree.
Thank you. Thank you.
Are there any
I
you, sorry, go
wish I
ahead.
had more time. I wish I had more time. It's just that you try to say a little bit of everything in such a short time.
Of course, and with 7,000 years of history, there's a lot to say.
Exactly. Exactly.
You mentioned the festivals and various events that go on year long. Are there any standout festivals, kind of must-see festivals, some of the bigger ones that you can recommend?
Definitely. As I mentioned, the local village festa, it's a must. So if you're there, your client is there from May till October, you definitely have to find where the village feast is, and there's usually more than one. And then the bigger festivals. I love the Baroque Festival, which happens in January. You have the Malta Jazz Festival, which is quite international, and that happens usually in July. I love the Burgo Fest and Notte Bianca, which is usually in October. There's just a few on the top of my head.
Sure.
As I said, there are plenty more throughout the year.
Of course. Great. Okay, I guess somebody's just asking if they can use your presentation on their website.
For sure, absolutely.
Awesome. And
And
they will.
I would also like to mention that on our visit Malta, there is a there's a media gallery, so you can download brochures, online brochures that you can send to your client online. We also have a YouTube channel with videos. So I also always recommend for travel agents to do that. We don't use brochures much apart from in fairs, but I think online brochures are accessible and they're great to forward.
Perfect. Somebody's asking your opinion on the best time to visit. Would it be either autumn or spring?
Both. I like both. I'm sorry, but I actually I'm an autumn person, so I like the fall. And when you say fall in Malta, September is still pretty warm, and it's still pretty high season because Europe they don't open until mid end of September, some of the schools. So October, if your client can travel October, November, I think it's ideal, or April, May also, especially around Easter time.
Sure. Excellent. Somebody's asking, are there any golf courses?
Yes, there is. There's one golf course, pretty accessible and accessible all year round.
Okay. And one other question, are there sandy beaches?
There are both sandy and rocky. So you'll find it's what's fascinating is that we in Gozo you'll find what we call Ramla Al Hamra, which is a bay with red sand. And then in Malta, there are other sandy beaches, but like different colors. It's a yellow sand, Golden Bay, which is beautiful yellow sand. Not long beaches that you can, that you will find, shorter, obviously, distance beaches. And then you have the rocky beaches that you can jump off, and usually equipped with ladders that one can go down, or a more rocky kind of shore.
Sure. Okay, great. Somebody's pointing out it looks like in your phone number there might be one too many fours. Just to clarify, your phone number is 212-213-0944.
Yes, for four. There is one extra four. Wow, good eye.
I can't take
Oh
credit
my
for that,
goodness. No, yeah, wow. Well done. I
paying
must have
attention,
pressed like,
see?
yes.
Somebody in regard to beaches, somebody's asking, is there snorkeling from the beaches? You
Yes,
mentioned
there
scuba
are.
diving, but can you snorkel off the
Yes.
beaches?
You can snorkel off the beaches. And even sometimes these scuba dive shops that you'll find everywhere, they offer snorkeling gear that you can rent for a couple of hours and you can just snorkel. They just give you like flippers and snorkeling gear and you can snorkel in any bay. And I would say like if you go to Camino or to the island of Gozo, it's definitely worth snorkeling.
Fantastic. Sign me up.
Yes.
Sounds really good right about now. Okay. Shell, it looks like it's all the questions that we had. Thank you
Great.
Again for hosting this webinar today.
My pleasure.
And thank you all travel professionals for attending the webinar. Again, it is recorded, so please watch for the email with that. And with that, we will wrap up today's webinar. Thank you all. Everybody stay well and stay safe. See you next time.
See you in Malta. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.